let's say this is the probability distribution fx of some random variable x. What would you say is the probability to randomly draw a value of x equals 0? Before we go to answering or discussing the solution, so maybe not all of you answered now the question on who read the notes or watched the videos. So far I got the impression that only very few of you actually did already look at the notes or watch the videos. So please, when you come here, most of this only makes sense if you come prepared in a sense. So this is a different kind of like lecturing than you might be used before. So you really need to look at the material before we gather here. Otherwise, this is only of really limited use. So please consider reading the notes beforehand. Otherwise, this is makes little sense. Okay, so here most of you answered that A is the question, is the answer of what is the probability to get a zero. The correct solution, however, is B. The probability to draw x equals zero is zero. And the reason for that is that a probability distribution is not a plot of probabilities. This shows you probability densities. And equal to like number densities of particles, let's say you have 10 particles in a cubic centimeter, this gives you 10 particles. But the density is per cubic centimeter, and if you have a volume of 0 cubic centimeter, you have 0 particles. So the probability described by a PDF corresponds to an area under the curve, and a single position has an area of 0. So B is the answer to that. Let's move on to number two. So as I mentioned, the probability corresponds to an area under the distribution. And for this example, the probability to get a negative x is the area under the curve from minus infinity to zero. So the integral of the PDF from minus infinity to zero corresponds to the probability to get a negative x. So it's about comparing the two areas here, and these are probability distributions. These are two Gaussian distributions, which means their total area is normalized to unity, and the peak position halves the probability. So consequently, if I integrate the blue curve from minus infinity to zero, I get an area of 0.5, and the area from the orange curve here is necessarily smaller because I didn't even reach zero. So the answer is A. Okay. So then, okay, there's a misnumbering here. So let's move on to number three. Okay, so let's stop. So we're talking about two C scores. From the lecture, we know that the C score is the distance of our observations from the mean value in units of standard deviations. And when we, for example, integrate a distribution from the C score to infinity, then we compute the probability to getting such an event or something even more unlikely. And so the answer is B, because this is more standard deviations away from the mean. The probability to get this result is 11.5%, while for the other it's 22%. Okay. And a final question. Now we have two different experiments, one with a large number of samples, a large sample, and one with a small sample. Okay, maybe we stop here. So there seems to be a big uncertainty. Okay. So what's a C-score, what's a T-score? They are the same thing, with the difference that the C-score is used for a standard normal distribution and a T-score is used for a student T-distribution, which applies in cases of a very small sample. And the difference between the T and the distribution and the normal distribution is that the T-distribution has a higher area, larger area under the wings, so a higher probability to get outcomes that are further away from the mean value. So that means when I go to a certain score and integrate from that to plus infinity, it will always be larger in the student T distribution, which makes the outcome for the normal distribution A here more unlikely, so has a lower probability. Here in this plot, I compare the blue curve is the normal distribution and this orange curve is the student T distribution. And you see that at some point here they swap the order. Nevertheless, when I go to 1 and integrate to plus infinity, then for the normal distribution I get this, and for the student T distribution this result, and if I compute this just as floating point number, the probability is larger for the student T distribution. The parameter here is 6 degrees of freedom because the sample size was 7. You could ask whether this is true for all scores here, and this is the general difference between the student T distribution and the normal distribution. And when we plot this, this is a positive number for all possible scores. And this is also true for all degrees of freedom. So the answer here on the question is that A is more unlikely. B has a higher probability. So then, even though some of most of you didn't check out the notes, I will move through the two chapters that I prepared here, because this is instructive anyways, and for those of you who already studied the chapter, even more so. So this is not my own example, but I borrowed this from these two Three Blue One Brown videos, which I highly recommend. Not only those, but the other, all the material they offer is excellent. And the blog post. And the whole idea is the following. Let's say you go to Amazon and want to buy something, and it's not an Amazon Prime product, but it's something that's being sold by some external resellers, and Amazon offers you the choice between three different resellers, and they have different customer ratings. The first one has a 100% positive rating thing out of 10 reviews. So 10 of the 10 customers said this was the perfect trade, very successful. Reseller B has a 96% positive rating from 50 reviews, and reseller C 93% positive ratings from 200 reviews. Now, you would of course like to have a positive trade experience, so this there should be no problems with shipping and with the payment, so you want to maximize the chance of a positive trade. Now, is review ratings of 100% satisfied customers from a small sample better than only 93% from a much larger sample? That's the question you need to answer for yourself. And what we're going to do here, we are trying to model this interaction between the reseller and the customer, and we do it as a Bernoulli experiment. You know from the lecture, a Bernoulli experiment is a random experiment with two possible outcomes, success or failure. This is exactly what can happen when you randomly buy, when you buy from one of the resellers, it can be either a positive or a negative experience. A Bernoulli experiment is described by a success probability of P, which is here the chance that this trade turns out to be positive. So that's all nice and fine. The whole problem here is that P, the success probability, is unknown for every reseller. The only thing we have is the result after n trials. If we knew the probability P, of course it's simple to pick the correct reseller, so we just take the one with the highest chance of successfully completing the interaction here. So let's look at reseller A. This 100% success rate could be the result, of course, of a success probability of 1. So a 100% success probability. Then the 10 positive reviews, of course, is no surprise. But even if a lower P is the case, it's still probable to get 10 successes out of 10 trials. So let's assume we have a 95% success probability. So the probability then of getting 10 out of 10 is described here by our binomial probability. We have here the binomial coefficient 10 over 10. We have the success probability to the power of 10 for 10 successes. And we have the failure probability to the power of 0 because we have no unsuccessful trade. And this is about 60%. So even if P is only 95%, there's a 60% chance that when 10 people buy from this reseller, they will have a positive, all will have a positive experience. Even if P is only 90%, this probability is still 35% to get 10 out of 10. So it's very unlikely that P is 1, but we cannot actually say whether it's 0.95 or 0.9, maybe 0.85 is still also in a reasonable range. So there is a whole range of possible probabilities. When we look at the two other resellers, just to get a feeling here for the effect of the sample sizes, let's assume we have a P of 0.95. Then to get 48 out of 50 positive trades is a 96% success rate. So that's 50 over 48. The success probability here times the failure probability, which is 26%. When we move with the same probability to reseller C, we now have 186 out of 200, then the probability to get this is already down to 5%. So here again, this is the binomial distribution. N is the total number of trade interactions. This is the number of successful trades, the success and the failure probability here. So plotting this for our three cases, this top one is A, bottom left is B, and this is C. We see the binomial distribution. This is, let's briefly look at the thing. This is just the PDF for the binomial distribution in case of 95% probability. Okay, this is not really helpful because we don't know the probability. We get a feeling for, there's a question here for, sorry. Okay, thank you for the reminder. Yes, I'm recording because the last one, I missed the last one. No, I'm recording. Thanks for the reminder. Okay, so what we so far did is we just now have a feeling that apparently if the sample size is very low, it's even more difficult to pinpoint an likely probability, underlying success probability for a given result. What we can do, but what we know is our data is for the reseller A, 10 positive, 10 positive trades. And we computed the probability of this in case P is 95. So we can do this, which means we can do this, we can compute this probability also for a large range of other underlying success probability. And this is what I do here. I just compute now on the x-axis. Maybe I should what I did here is I just for all the probabilities between 0 and 1 in steps of 0.05 0.01, I compute the probability to get 10 out of 10. So what I do here is basically a distribution of probabilities for a certain probability. So a probability distribution over probabilities. This is not yet a true probability distribution because you might recall that the area under the curve needs to be 1, and this area is significantly smaller than 1. But what we plot here is the probabilities. So you recall the PDF didn't show probabilities. So for 0.8, the probability to get 10 out of 10, if the success probability would have been 0.8, is something like 10%. If it's 90%, we have something like 34%, and so on. Now, this function peaks at a probability of 1. That is no big surprise, because this is exactly our experimental result. This is our data. And we not actually expect P to be 1. There is no perfect reseller here. Now, we can do this also for the other cases. And this I do here. So the top one is for reseller B, and this is for reseller C. Again, the y-axis now shows you the probability for a given underlying success probability. That's not normalized to unity. It's not a PDF yet. And again, these two things here peak at 96% and 93%. That was exactly what our data showed for these two resellers. So, what we can do with these is, if we convert this to a PDF by normalizing the area, and so you know the thing, then we can of course compute something, the probability for here for reseller A, that his success probability is above 90%. So we can do this. And we can do this also for the others. And to normalize this, what we would have to do is we have to integrate this expression over P from 0 to 1 to get the normalization factor by which we have to divide. And you saw this in the lecture. If we integrate this expression, what we get is the beta function. So, or this, and that can be expressed again in these gamma functions. So integrating the general binomial distribution gives me here this expression. So the binomial itself is not a function of the probability, so it's just a constant factor. And we have here the gamma expressions. This is a conditional expression because the n needs to be larger than the success number, and s needs also to be basically a larger than minus 1. But okay. So with this, we can just take the expression I used to plot the curves here, divided by our normalization, which cancels out the binomial and leaves us with this expression here. This is basically the beta distribution. So when I plot this for our reseller number B, we have 50 trials and 48 successes. This is what we get. The shape is the same. The only thing that changed is that we now peak here at an y value of 14, while we saw here the probability. this is, so now the area here is 1. And now this is not a probability, but a probability density. If I integrate this here, just as verification, the result is 1. So, how does this help us? We can now use the PDF, as we discussed in the lecture notes, to compute the expectation value. What's the expected outcome of this result, of this probability random experiment? So if I perform many, many interactions with one of the reseller after many trades, what is the expected success rate? And to do so, we integrate our PDF times the probability. This is somehow related, so somehow equivalent to the center of mass of this distribution. That's the most expected outcome. And very nicely, if we integrate this expression, so here, P is not, so this P and this P combine, so if we have an P to the power of S plus 1, we get this expression in terms of gamma functions. And if we put in now our, for example, number of trials and number of successes, I get 11 divided by 12. This is the expectation value for the success probability of our reseller A, which is about 92%. So with this success probability, the this is our expected result when we interact with this reseller. And so we are looking for an S because, now this number, when we would put in here not numbers, but the expression, what was it? P plus 1 divided by R plus 1 or so, we have the expression, or N plus 2, we have the expression that we discussed in the lecture from Laplace rule of succession, where we did the same thing and estimate the success probability based on an event that occurs R times out of successfully out of n trials. And Laplace derived that a good estimate of P is this expression. Here R is 10. 10 successes out of n equals 10 trials is 11 by divided by 12. So that's the same thing. When we extend this to the two other cases, we get 49 out of 52, which is 94% for B, and 187 divided by 202, which is 93%. So we can now conclude that reseller B has the highest expected success rate of all three resellers. And so it's not the one with the largest sample, because the larger the sample size is, the more narrowly peaked our distribution is around the true underlying success probability. And this is okay if we compare two resellers with many reviews, then the peak value is already a nice estimate because the distribution itself is very narrow, But when we compare it to less or to lower sample sized results, then this is not helpful. So we have to compute the expectation value. There is also a really nice and straightforward interpretation of this number here, 11 by 12, or this one. So a surprisingly simple analogy is, let's say you are with reseller A that has 10 positive out of 10 trials. So this is the following Bernoulli sequence. Trade 1, success. Trade 2, success. And so on up to trade number 10. We now expand this sequence by one additional success and one failure. So 11 successes and the 12th is a failure. And the probability to exactly get this sequence is 11 divided by 12, which is the result that we found here. So this is how you can easily, from the numbers in the reviews, number of positives, number of totals, compute the expected probability. Based on this Laplace rule of succession, which we here derived independently for integer n's and s. Next topic. We were talking about distribution functions, how a distribution function describes the probability and the distribution of the related random variates. Now let's say you have a function that depends on two random numbers, and the only thing you know is the distribution of these input random numbers x and y. You know here they are distributed according to two different probability distributions. And after drawing x and y, you are taking the sum of the two, and you are interested what is now the distribution of this sum. So it turns out that in that particular case, the probability distribution of the C is described by the convolution integral of the distribution of F and G. And what we are doing here basically is we are computing the probability to find a C for all possible combinations of X and Y. So let's say you draw an integer, a variable y from the distribution g, and the sum c depends now on the x that you draw from your distribution f. So you have to integrate over all possible cases of x, but not all x's are possible, only those that add up with y to the c that you are interested in. So we replace the x with c minus y, which is, and then compute the total integral, because multiplying two probability distribution corresponds to the probability of y and x. Okay, so we integrate now over all possible y's for a given c. And of course, this is symmetric, because also start with a distribution X and then integrate over all possible related Ys. And this integral here is a convolution integral, where we convolve two functions f and g over the range y, or the range, this should actually be here an x. Okay. So the convolution helps us to construct the combined probability distribution function of the C. Let's look at some examples. Let's say we have two independent, uniformly distributed variables x and y, all coming from the interval 0 to 1. What is the density of their sum? So the distribution for x and y is described by this function, so which is just a step function between 0 and 1. And the density function of the sum, according here to the convolution integral, can be written down like this. We put in y, which is just in our interval from 0 to 1, 1. And for the fx, we have to convert the x to c minus y and integrate it from 0 to 1. Okay. Now, when we do the integral, we have to distinguish between certain cases, because when we choose a certain value of c minus y, it may rule out certain values of x which are just too low to get us the correct sum, so their probability is zero. So this integrand is zero unless this c minus y is between 0 and 1. Or when we replace this, unless c minus 1 is smaller or equal than y, smaller or equal than c. And in this range, it's 1. So we can convert this to this integral, which gives us c. If we are adding up two random numbers that are between 0 and 1, the maximum possible result can be 2. So c can also be between 1 and 2. In this case, we have to integrate this interval from 2 to, and which gives us 2 minus c. And we have the possibility that c is either larger than 2 or smaller than 0, then the probability is 0. So the result of this convolution under the constraint of x plus y needs to be c for any number between 0 and 2 is this function. And when we plot this, this is the distribution. So it's just this tent function, this triangular distribution, which increases to 1 at 1 and goes down to 2, and this area is exactly 1, which is nice. So automatically the convolution conserves the area under the individual probability distribution functions. In Mathematica, I can test this by computing the transformed distribution from two variables and specify how the individual ones are distributed. And when I do this, I get here the same PDF. So this is the probability distribution function of two uniformly distributed random variables that we add up. And using this scheme, we can now check how do variables add up that are from a, coming from different distributions. So let's look at exponential variables. Now, fx and fy is just here this exponential distribution with lambda taken such that we normalize the area and we limit it to the range between 0 and 1. So for positive c's, we can write down the convolution, insert basically our formula here and replace the x again with the transformed value. And this gives us this expression here. It's again an exponential with a modified factor to make sure that we are again normalized. Here the case distinguish distinguishing between the different cases is easier. And when we plot this function, it looks like this. Again, this is also confirmed by what here Mathematica tells us should be the expected result. The difference to the individual distributions is that this now extends to larger values because we add up the ones where the x goes only from 0 to 1, but modified with this exponential. Okay, how does this look for the normal distribution? So when we convolve two normal distributions with two mean values and two variances, then the result is again a normal distribution. So two Gaussians adding up gives again a new Gaussian, with the new mean being the sum, and the new variance being the quadratic sum of the variances. So you might already know this. And we will look here now as this in the special case of standard normal distribution. So with a sigma of 0, of 1 and a mean of 0, just to make the integrals easier. So we are looking at the convolution of these two, writing down here the product of the first Gaussian from y and the second Gaussian of c minus y, and pull out the prefactor here. We can separate the exponential here in a c and a y term and pull out the c because we integrate over y. And then write down here this rearrange the formula like this. And this expression here is 1 because this is basically the integral of the normal density with 0 mean and this sigma. So this is 1. Oops. This is 1. Leaves us with the other part. So the distribution of C is again just a Gaussian distribution with a modified sigma here. So a sigma, a variance of 2. And we plot this and compare it with the transformed distribution expression from Mathematica, that's the same. So this is the general scheme, how you derive the properties of combined distributions. So when you perform random operations or logical operations like AND or, which means you add up probabilities or you multiply random variables, you can construct the properties of the new combined variate by combining the individual distributions, and we already saw this to some degree in. Did we already see this, or is this only in the upcoming lectures? So you will see this in the hypothesis chapters that are coming now, where we combine, for example, the sum of quadratic normal distributed variables, which gives it basic, or where we sum up many normal distributed things that gives us the standard or the central limit theorem, for example. That's how you derive this. Okay, you can expand this to summing up n independent variables. So where you convolve, where you have the n-fold convolution basically. And let's look here at two cases. Let's say all the x's are uniformly distributed. Then without derivation, this n-fold convolution is given by this term here. And so here n is the number of variables that I add up. And x is the sum of these n variables. And when I plot this expression for n's from 2 to 10 in steps of 2. So this triangle thing is what we saw previously. So adding up 2, this is adding up 4, 6, 8, and 10. And again, this is how this looks for 4. I did it only for 4 because it becomes a little bit clumsy for like 10. And if you look at the case for 10, adding up 10 uniformly distributed variables looks terribly Gaussian, doesn't it? Now, when I look at the, when I take the expression here for this term, so this one for an n of 10, and maximize it, then the maximum is at 5. With a height of 0.43. And if I overlay the Gaussian distribution that is centered at 5 with a peak value of this, you see that this is almost a perfect Gaussian. And what we see here is the central limit theorem. Adding up many things will end up to be Gaussian. And this is, of course, also because the convolution can also be expressed in Fourier space, so basically with exponentials, no matter the actual form of the f's here. Okay, so if x is not uniformly distributed, but normally we can do this again, and here the n-fold convolution of n Gaussian distributions is this simple new Gaussian where we have just a modification of the variance term here. And these are the cases for different number of Gaussians that we convolve with each other. And this is the explicit confirmation of the case 5 here, which is the same plot. So Gaussian distributions are neat because taking the sum, so this is basically the OR case, is again a Gaussian distribution. And we will make use of this in later cases. But we already saw this for the conditional probabilities. So when we compute combined joint distribution function also in the conditional case, when at some point, if you are Gaussian, this remains to be Gaussian and throughout the computations. Okay, so this is what I wanted to share with you.